Gives me great pleasure to introduce to you Dr. David Cole, our first speaker. He's currently a professor emeritus in the Department of Agriculture and Applied Economics at Virginia Tech. He has traveled over 8.5 million miles throughout his professional career, conducting more than 6,000 workshops and seminars for agricultural groups worldwide. He regularly writes for Farm Journal, Top Producer, Ag Lender, Journal of Agricultural Lending, and Soybean Digest. He has received 11 major teaching awards while teaching over 10,000 students. On a more personal note, he enjoys playing and coaching basketball, farms, dogs, and covered bridges. And he dislikes administrative bureaucracies and paperwork. Please welcome Dave Cole.
All righty, here we go. Let's hear a good Wiffles good morning.
Good morning.
I'll tell you what, she's a tough act to follow. I needed her for my workout this morning at 4:30 a.m. That would get you going. Well, hey, folks, it's a pleasure to be here with you this morning and to kick off this 10th anniversary type of event. Let me further introduce myself. I'm Dave Cole from Virginia Tech. I've been down there for about 37, 38 years, originally from upstate New York, grew up about 60 miles north of Syracuse, New York, on a dairy farm up there, and our family still has the dairy farm. As it was mentioned in the introduction, I taught entrepreneurship, problem solving, and agricultural finance at Virginia Tech and Cornell, taught over 10,000 students. The other aspect about my life is I do a significant amount of travel. Last year I was in 38 states, 5 Canadian provinces. I was just at a deal where we had 47 countries from around the world looking at agriculture, looking at business and economics in the year 2030. In other words, we were going out there about a number of years. And one thing I'm going to tell you, the more I travel the world, the older I get, the less I know. This world, she will humble you and humble you very, very quickly. Also come to you as a fellow agriculture producer. It's real interesting coming down 74 this morning, looking at those cornfields. You know what our cornfields look like? This, right here. We're extremely dry. Corn's curling back in our part of Virginia. But we have a dairy operation. About 14 years ago, we decided to do something a little different. We put in a processing unit, and it's real interesting now. We bottle our milk in the old-fashioned glass bottle. We're selling almost 100,000 gallons of milk a month. We have 43 flavors of premium ice cream, so I got to check the ice cream out there. And it's the high-fat stuff. You don't have to eat a lot. You have to exercise a lot, and it'll clog you and kill you, but what a way to go, you know? And the food police wouldn't like that one, okay? But you know what else? During the holiday period, we sell about 150,000 quarts of eggnog and custard. And you know what we did about 6-7 years ago? And they talk about family business, and ours is a family business. And that built America. Family businesses build America. About 7 years ago, we decided to bring the milkman back, and we launched home delivery, where we actually go door to door. Got some folks up from Kentucky. We just had a group come in Monday morning, drove all night to come and tour our business. And they asked, do the milkmen leave the milk in the box? Yeah, but they also take it right into the refrigerator in the morning. And of course, have that lady greet you. That'd be kind of interesting. But all joking aside, that little old business we started out with $670,000 in revenue. We're now shooting toward $10 million in revenue. And that's how that business has grown. So today, when we talk about the subject matter in hand, I'm going to talk to you as an academic. Going to talk to you as a traveler, but I'm also going to talk to you as a person with skin in the game, okay? And so what I'm going to do is take you up 50,000 foot. We're going to look at global economics. I'm not going to talk about the markets, and I'm going to talk and take you a walk around the world, but I'm also going to talk and intersperse it with some things that are going to be very, very critical for the next 6 or 7 years as you manage your businesses and position your business for the future, because I noticed a lot of the younger generation is here. And it's going to be very, very critical to teach that younger generation very, very well, because many of us with gray hair or no hair lived through the 1980s, okay? And those periods do come occasionally, and again, they can be very teachable times. And so, again, that's what I've got. I'm going to stay around for the morning. Matter of fact, our next speaker will be on. And so if you've got questions, I'll be around here to take any questions. So I look forward to being with you. Now, got a series of PowerPoints here, and I may cover all of them. I may not. That's my choice. Call a Peyton Manning audible. But one of the things that's real interesting, last December, I was in Bruning, Nebraska. Bruning, Nebraska, 276 people. Been going there for 15 years. Speak at the Opera House. 180 people out, okay? And I gave my talk, and you know what? One of the young guys in there, he was 28 years of age, he says, Dr. Cole, your talk was less than compelling today. In other words, you sounded kind of cup half empty instead of half full like you normally are, because I talked about moderating prices, et cetera, et cetera. He actually wrote me a question, and he says, give me some compelling reasons why I should be interested in agriculture and be optimistic about agriculture. Now, folks, you're going through a little dipsy-doo right now, but let's go out and think about a little bit long-term, and let's hit item number one up here on my screen. It's called the 50-70-70 rule. And basically, it's this. By the year 2050, and a lot of you say that's a long time away, I can remember when the year 2000 was a long time away. That gentleman right there and I were together in a workshop in 1984, okay? And we both looked the same age, all right? But what's real interesting, by 2050, we're going to need 70% more food, fiber, and fuel. But here's your key. Your key is we're only going to be using 70% of the resources that we use today. Your key, and it was mentioned up here. And I've been saying it for about 4 or 5 years. Remember, better is better before bigger is better. Get efficient before you get bigger. When you go away from this meeting today, you go out and you observe the exhibits. I want you to be thinking about what are three ways that we can become more efficient in our operation. That could be from production-wise, marketing-wise, financial-wise, or just overall operation systems. Remember, get efficient before you get bigger, okay? Better is better before bigger is better. That is one of the things that outstanding businesses do. Second element that I want to discuss is this. You know, I was part of the farm financial crisis. Now the farm financial crisis, we created the farm financial standards. Dr. Tom Fried, University of Illinois, and Danny Kleinfelder from Illinois. We were on the original task force. And you know what? That was one of the best blessings we've ever had. Because you know what we have now? Over 50,000 farmers on farm record databases. No, this is not your USDA statistics. Nothing against USDA statistics. These are the people that are above average that you need to benchmark yourself with. Now, you know what's interesting? Go back to 1995 and go all the way till 2013. And it's real interesting. The top 20% of producers generated a 10% rate of return on asset. Tell me any business that is legal that has generated a 10% rate of return. By the way, I'll be in Boulder, Colorado all next week, okay? So I have to kind of mention that. But what's real interesting is this. The bottom 20%, 1% are negative. And listen up, folks. How have those folks stayed in business in the past 15, 20 years? You know what they've done? They have basically used land appreciation to keep them going. And folks, one of the things is Warren Buffett, the famous billionaire, he's got a famous saying that I think is very applicable to agriculture, and particularly for Midwest agriculture. And you know what he says? When the tide goes out, you find out who's naked. And boy, when the real estate tide goes out or softens, we're going to find out who the real good managers have been, okay, and will be into the future. Now, again, you're going to see a widening gap of profitability. You know what the third element that's really critical? It's not one size that fits all. And that's what makes American business. Everybody says American agriculture is going corporate. I tend to disagree. There's a place for the big farm. There's a place for the small farm. There's a place for the family farm. And boy, one of the things about a tweener farm, if you keep your debts half modest, focused on efficiency, keep your living costs modest, and you know what? A number of family farms will tell me the best crop they'll ever raise has nothing to do with out in the field. It's their children, grandchildren, and neighbor kid. Never forget that, okay? And one of the things that I would, what are you guys hitting each other here, okay? Yeah, he's the neighbor kid. All right, well, sorry about that. You get out of here, all right? But all joking aside, agriculture, it is not one size that fits all. And boy, that initial discussion up here is very, very important. In other words, you can be any size and still make it. Next element that I'd like to talk about is this. Every business in this room needs to position you yourself for what I call creative destruction. You know what the creative destruction is going to be? The younger generation and the new people coming into agriculture. It's real interesting. Dr. Danny Kleinfeller's TPAP, some of you have been down there. And Dr. Kleinfelder was the visionary of it. And of course, he's got some health issues. He's stepping down. And they ask a couple of us speakers who have been there for 25 years, what's the biggest change that we have seen? Folks, these are not your biggest farms. These are your most progressive because they're all lifelong learners that go to that deal, okay? And you know what the biggest change I've seen? Let's go 25 years ago. Look at my talks 25 years ago. You know what people were concerned about? Basically, it was white males that were 50 to 65 years of age that were concerned about what was going to happen to farm program payments. This year, I ask everybody under 42 years of age, I don't know why I selected 42, but I did. I asked them to stand up. It was 60% of the group. And you know what they were interested in? How to become better business managers, but also how to become better family people, too. You ought to see how our curriculum has changed at that. And one of the things that I would tell you, get ready for this new wave of young folks coming along. Matter of fact, you know, one of the things, what keeps my motor going, I could retire, but one of the things is, I call it my bridge strategy, bridging the old concepts to this new younger generation of people, okay? Because I'm grandfather now, and people listen to your grandfather, okay? They won't listen to your mom and dad. You know what the second thing I'm seeing? More and more women. Oh, yeah. And one of the things that you'll find is, originally, we had one or two females. Now, it was almost 20% of the group, and we're also seeing minorities. Folks, this is going to shape the future of agriculture out here, and so that's bringing a whole new energy. Next bullet that's real important is this. Get ready for what I would call the convergence of three sets of technology in your business. Number one, bio, engineering, and information. And remember, it's not about technology. It's about technology and innovation. And here is the one thing that scares me about technology. You know what we have a tendency to do? Check our brains at the door. We don't use good old common sense. Hear that one? And one of the things that I would suggest to you is, regardless of the size of your business, if you can take on this technology, some of it, but also look at it as innovation, one of the things is, and put it together as a system, it's going to be very important. And you know who's going to be important for you? This younger generation. Because they get technology, but sometimes they don't get innovation. Okay? And that is where your mentoring kind of comes in and brings common sense to the whole thing. So get ready for that type of wave. What's real interesting is this, as we go to the next bullet. A real challenge is coming to agriculture and rural America. And you know what it's called? Talent war. And somebody asked me, what's the biggest mistake? It was interesting. Monday morning, these folks got up at 11 o'clock at night, drove all night to come to our creamery. And the first question out of it, they said, what's your core values? So I kind of flipped those out. My president, he locked up. But they asked, what's the biggest mistake you've made? And you know what it was? Surrounded people, overpaying poor people, okay? And one of the things that I'm just going to tell you is you're going to have talented people around you. That is employees, family members, suppliers, et cetera, lenders. It's going to be very, very important. And what's real interesting, I'll give you a little story. Let's go to Holdridge, Nebraska. I'm out there doing a deal, and one of the producers comes up to me and he says, you know, I've got to have a spray applicator that has the talents of a jet fighter pilot. And I go, get out of here. What are you talking about? He says, today, with the cost of land, cost of inputs, one screw up can cost me $500,000 just like that. Interesting. I'm doing a deal in Phoenix, Arizona last winter. It was ag retail deal. And one of the owners told me he was 72 years of age, and he was having a bad day because he just got kicked off the board of directors from the bank. He was too old, okay? And you know what he basically said? He said he hired the bank president's son to come into his business. Real interesting. The son was a know-it-all and wouldn't follow directions. You know what happened? They sent him out to spray a field. Problem is, he went in the wrong field. He went into a field of organic, and he sprayed it. Ended up costing that firm $500,000 because of a know-it-all. And one of the things that I am just going to tell you is this, and I'm talking as a university person. Not everybody needs a college degree. There's nothing wrong with vocational and technical school. Matter of fact, your universities are going to get turned upside down in the next 10, 15 years. You watch it. And one of the things is, as we take on this technology and innovation, we have got to surround ourselves with talent. It's going to be very, very important. Another thing that's real important, we got the entrepreneurial segment, but I'm going to talk a little bit about this as I go into my next slide. I'm going to talk about, you've got to keep an eye on, if you're going to be good to great, you've got to keep an eye on the global economy. But before I go there, one of the things that I would just suggest to you, we had some great discussion with these guys over here this morning. They were talking about another, quote, famous speaker that was my office mate at Cornell, and I'm not going to mention his name. But one of the things that I often tell people is this. Economics is not about logic. It's about emotion and behavior. I don't know if you realize this. 80% of all economic decisions are based off emotion. It's like when the 80 comes up next door. It's not logic. She's emotion. And what's going to happen is our moms and dads, our grandmothers and grandfathers had to manage volatility. In the next 5 to 10 years, you're going to have to manage volatility in extremes. And you know what? Volatility is great because there's going to be more opportunity in agriculture in the next 5 to 10 years than there has been in the past 30, but there's going to be more opportunity to fail. She's got an upside and she's got a downside. Okay? Now, here are some of the emotions that you're going to have to kind of manage. You know what number one is? Greed. And listen to this. Greed has been rewarded in the past 5, 6, 7, 8 years. You know why? Easy money. And one of the things is grow at all costs. Okay? And you know, one of the things is we were doing a banker panel, Topeka, Kansas last year. Had a producer and his wife was on the panel. You know what he said? I followed Kansas State's risk marketing and risk management program. And he said, I left $500,000 on the table. He says, I'll never do that one again. Okay? Let's put it this way, two comments. You never say what? And you know what the other thing is? You're going to be in this business, you're going to leave profits on the table and just get over it. Okay? And one of the things that I would just suggest to you, we are coming into a period of years where the greed emotion, grow at all costs, is going to be penalized. You watch it. And you know who scares me? My younger agriculture producers under 42 years of age. Haven't had the dipsy-doo. Okay? And that's going to be interesting to see how they handle it. Next emotion, anxiety, that's good. You know what a lot of you are asking? When are interest rates going to go up? By the way, I'm going to give you a comment. The new 17, 18, 19, 20% interest rates are actually going to be 8% because that is going to have that much of a relative impact shock to you. Think about it. The new 17 to 20% interest rate will actually be 8%. Okay, because we've been down so long. You know what the other element that's going to be very important? Complacency. I was doing a banker deal up in South Dakota, And that was the whole theme for the school a couple weeks ago, complacency. You can feel it. It's hit in. You're seeing complacency in the stock market right now, okay? You're seeing complacency in agriculture. And I'll give you an example. Hey, let's go out here, hit 74, we'll cruise on over, and then we're gonna hit 29, we're gonna head into Canada. I go up, I do a lot of work in Canada with Royal Bank of Canada. And they call it the speaking series, and they call me the doctor. And one of the things that's real interesting, I will give speeches, but then you know what RBC does? They actually have me meet with individual customers, and they come in for about a 45-minute appointment. And sometimes I go out to their place, and you know what I'm there to do? Is basically assess them in 45 minutes on their management, okay? So one evening, snowing and blowing, and those Canadians, they'll come out to a deal, you know. And I went out to this guy's farm, and he was an alpha dog. He was a growing agriculture producer. Had 5,000 acres of corn. It was real interesting. 165 bushel, and the farm ground at $3,200 an acre, cash rent, 165 bucks an acre. Think about that in global economics. He also had, what, 5,000 acres of soybeans. Yeah, global warming, right? No. Matter of fact, one of the biggest crops being exported out of Canada is what? Soybeans, because of seed technology. Also had 5,000 acres of potatoes, 5,000 acres of wheat. So I started asking him a question. I says, you got your corn harvested? And he says, yep, got her all in the bin, eh? I says, how much you got forward priced? Well, about 10%, eh? About that time, his royal banker turned pale. The old Royal Bank, $21 million, had $800,000 of debt service. And he only had, what, 10% forward price. And you know what his next question was? Oh, in the spring of 2014, corn prices are going to come back up, eh? I says, no, you know. And you know what was real interesting? I then asked him another question. I says, do you know your cost of production? And you know what? He did not know his cost of production on that big of a business. And listen to this. He had audited financial statements. To any lender in here that says, I got to have audited financial statements, that's okay. But if that producer doesn't use them in their business and measuring various factors, you might as well have no records at all. Did you hear that? He didn't know his cost. Actually, he knew his cost. His wife knew it because she used to keep the records, and he got rid of her. Okay? And it was real interesting. So, had to grade this guy out. You know what I did? I graded him A+ on production management. Oh, he could get production. You know, he could get these fields looking real good. But, of course, I graded him an F on marketing and risk management. I also graded him an F on financial management. Because basically, he had all these fancy records, but they weren't talking to him. And you know what? He basically put the seed in the ground. Prices were going up. And you know what his strategy was? With that easy money, grow at all costs. And basically, he was demarketed. Complacency is not going to work. Sense of optimism, I've already talked about this, but she's a very fragile environment. You know what I often tell people? It's like our business. You know what I told the Kentucky group the other day, and they were looking at our business? And I says, remember, this business is 90 days away from bankruptcy. Okay? At any given time, that's how fragile this environment is out here. And so, again, keep that in mind. Now let's go up and go global, okay? That's a busy slide up there, but that is what's driven Midwest economics. And you know who they're called? For all you folks in the Bob Uecker seats out there, come on in, and on this side. It's real interesting. It's called the BRICS and the KMTs. These are nations. As I told this group over here, I was doing a pre-seminar with them. I said, basically, the Midwest and agriculture in rural America never faced the deep recession of 2008. You know what? You're not tied to the U.S. You're tied to those global nations. And it's real interesting. Who are the BRICS and the KMTs? Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa. And then there's a subset, South Korea. Not North Korea, where Dennis Rodman's our new ambassador, okay? All right. Oh, boy. Now you know why some mothers eat their young. All right. But he was a good rebounder, though. Okay. Now back to my story. You got South Korea, Indonesia, Turkey, and Mexico. You take those nations, think about what's happened since the year 2000 and how important it is to you. Since the year 2000, those nations have been 53% of the world economic growth. Standard of living in Europe, United States, and Japan, our buying power has gone down anywhere from 7 to 13%. These nations, their buying power went up 6 times, okay? And as their buying power went up, you know what they demanded? Food, fiber, and fuel. What do we produce? What's right around this tent, okay? And so one of the things is this. I've got my famous 8-5-3 rule. Write this down. It's not up there. It's very simple. If you see these nations growing at about an 8% or greater GDP, gross domestic product, you're going to see a lot of demand for commodities. Corn, beans, wheat, oil, steel. You know what your big bellwether is globally? Copper. Remember this. When people are stealing copper in rural areas, those emerging nations are doing real well. No, I'm very serious, because that is your bellwether commodity. All right? Now, if they drop back to a 5%, what you will see is commodities will moderate. If they go to 3%, then you're going to see commodities really start to come off. By the way, it's real interesting. China, 30 years, grew at a 10.8% growth rate. She's back about 7% right now. Okay? And what's real interesting, the average is 3%, but the composite average is about 4%. One of the things, and I said this a year ago in January, these emerging nations were softening, and we would see a softening of corn prices and commodity prices. And that is one of your compelling factors. So keep an eye on these nations, really, really critical to the pocketbook of you all, the BRICS and the KMTs. Now, let's walk around the world. Why am I in here talking about Europe this morning? You know who China's number one customer is? Europe. It's not the United States. And here's one thing I'm going to tell you. Listen up on this one. Go over, take a trip in Europe, and watch for their social trends, political trends, economic trends, and consumer trends. And that's what we'll see in the United States 10 to 15 years from now. Ask any Dutch farmer that's come over here, a lot of our Dutch dairymen, Canada, United States, you know what they'll say? We came to the United States for a window to operate, okay? And one of the things that is happening in Europe, keep an eye on Germany. Why? Because it's the fourth largest economy in the world. And why is Germany critical? Their chancellor, Chancellor Merkel, boy, last fall, I was glad she was reelected, because you know what was interesting? She kept the euro together. Boy, if she had not kept the euro together, we would have had some problems. And think about Europe. Northern Europe is the producers, Southern Europe's the takers. Okay? I'm being blunt. And so what's happened is it's relegated this quarter of the world economy to slow economic growth. Now, we got that little region called Ukraine. It's real interesting. I got a student enrolled in my online course. She's in Kiev. And she kind of gives me the inside of what's going on. But it's real interesting. 60% of Ukraine wants to go with Europe. The other 40% want to go back to Putin. Okay? And you know what the other thing is about Ukraine? Very critical as far as energy for Europe. T. Boone Pickens, the old famous oil guy, down in Texas, did a commercial, and you didn't see it probably too much. It was on CNBC. Showed the lights going out in Europe, and you know what he basically said? That's what happens when you depend on your enemy for energy. Folks, I'm going to tell you one thing right up front as my man hits his iPad over there. One of the things in positioning yourself for the future that really scares me is this. There is a tendency where we've got what? 85% of the U.S. population is 2 generations from the farm. By the year 2050, 70% of your world population will be urban. And the more and more they get distant from agriculture, agriculture gets taken for granted. And you know what? One thing I'll say at this meeting, right here, July 9th, 2014, is if we aren't careful, agriculture will become oil of the 70s, 80s, and 90s. Because what will happen is, The regulation will push our agriculture into these emerging nations that comes with economic, political, and military risk. So your volatility, you've only seen the beginning of it, okay? And one of the things is it's a major worldwide trend that is kind of interesting, and it's kind of sneaking up on us. And of course, our typical public out here with, you think about it, who watches TV? Average mentality is a seventh grader. Okay, and so they're very easily swayed. And so they don't even get it. And so agriculture gets taken for granted. Now let's go to our friends in China. Oh boy, I was just with 10 Chinese leaders, not at the premier's level, but at a little lower level. And it was real interesting. I says, what keeps your guy up at night, your leader up at night? And you know what they said? Just like that. He's worried about social unrest in China. And what's the quickest way to social unrest? When they can't feed themselves, clothe themselves, and fuel themselves. Okay? And you know what's real interesting? China's got an issue. What's the issue? Natural resources. 50% of the water in northern China cannot be used to even wash in. It's that dirty. Interesting, 21% of its soils. Think about the soil that's under here. You know, the beautiful soil in this area. 21% of their arable soil, which is limited, is toxic. Another issue is what? Air quality, okay? And so what's happening is they're making strategic purchases around the world. For example, my state, Smithfield Food. And I ask them, why'd they buy Smithfield Food? Food safety protocol and an internationally recognized brand. My business partner was just in China, walked into the grocery store. They had China milk, U.S. milk. China milk, $6-$7 a gallon. U.S. milk, $9-$11 a gallon. Very little U.S. milk. You know why? Because what? The consumer over there trusted U.S. milk. And one of the things that I will tell you, China has got an issue there. Here's the other thing I'm going to make at this meeting. I've got all this media and press here. Make sure you get the whole story, because I spoke to a bunch of commissioners of agriculture around, they were from around the United States recently in Charlottesville, Virginia. You know what I said? Don't bet your farm on trade with China. Oh, it got them kind of upset. And let me tell you the rest of the story, because that'll be the headline out of this meeting. The rest of the story is this. China is a great market, but as China gets more military, political, and economic might, they're going to become tougher negotiators with you. For example, all of a sudden, oh, GMO's in the corn. Yep, oh, soybean. Whoa. And oftentimes, agriculture gets put into what? A box, in a sense that it may not even be an agricultural issue. For example, the recent spat with Japan over the Three Islands. Of course, the United States is an ally with Japan. Oh, hey, we don't want your corn. We don't want your soybeans. A few years ago, their tires kept falling off on the interstate. And so we put a sanction on their tires. Within 48 hours, they said, we don't want your poultry. That's the world economics. And so what do you do as individual producers? Remember, working capital and cash is going to be very, very critical as you play in a global economic market, because that market can be giveneth and it can be takeneth away just like that, okay? So don't bet the farm on China, but China's good. If you do bet the farm on trade with China, one of the things is make sure you've got your reserves. Now, I've talked a little bit about them already. Let me talk about another issue, FarmGram, all right? Everybody's asking me on my webcast. I had 400 people on a webcast the other day. What about farmland? What about the stock market? Folks, I was down at watching the Cardinals play last year a couple of times. The organization was very generous and allowed me to go to the games. Now, it's interesting. We were in the skybox, but I wanted to be out with the real people. It was interesting. I'm sitting there. Sixth inning, Clayton Kershaw was pitching, Los Angeles Dodgers. I looked around the baseball stadium, and guess what? Half the crowd wasn't even watching the ball game. What were they doing? They're on their phones, they were texting and tweeting. Again, they checked their brains at the door. And it was real interesting. I looked down the left field line. I'll never forget it, because I grew up a New York Yankees fan. I like the Cardinals, too. I like the Cubs, too. But, they were a good ball at Ferguson Jenkins and, you know, Ernie Banks and kind of like that. I go way back, Ron Santo. But, you know what was real interesting is, I looked down that left field line that has Big Mac land. That's where Mark Pegorer broke Roger Maris's record. And all of a sudden it came to me. Agriculture like baseball's on steroids. And you know who's the steroids? Our whole economy's on steroids. And it's all the result of the Central Bank of the United States of America, but also central banks around the world. It's real interesting. Did we need that stimulus in 2008 from the Federal Reserve? You dad gone right, because we were 3 weeks away from a Great Depression. I don't know if you folks realize we were going off the cliff. Now the second and the third one, once we got on the steroids, we kind of liked them. So we continued them. And two things that have really increased the balance sheets of American agriculture. Number one is the low interest rates, and number two has been the low value of the dollar. Okay? And that Federal Reserve practice is now being practiced in Europe, Japan, et cetera, et cetera. Look at the stock market. Dow 6,400, she's 16,800 now. And you know what that creates? The wealth effect. What's the wealth effect? Every time a stock goes up a buck in value, we'll pull $10 out of there, go to the other pocket here. We spend 4 cents more because we feel good about ourselves. You know where we're really feeling good about ourselves? Is in real estate, because every time it goes up a dollar, we spend 9 cents more. Okay? And what I am trying to tell you is, watch your central bank of the United States of America. And you know what it's going to do? It's going to come back. When they start tightening down and raising those interest rates, one of the things that you're going to see, it's going to have an impact on your margin, and it's going to have an impact on your land values. And listen on margin. Folks, I'm not worried about the strength of the U.S. farm balance sheet. It's really good buoyed by land. What I am really worried about is operating, because that's where you're going to face it first. A lot of people say, I've got fixed interest rates, or a lot of you say, well, I'm going to use my cash to buy my input. But one of the things is we start seeing these tighter margins. We're burning through working capital. And then we're going to start having to use operating money, and that'll be the first place they'll raise their interest rates. Okay? And so, again, Federal Reserve, United States of America, a very, very key. Now, let's look at this one. What are some of the barometers? And this slide's a little bit old, but let me update you. I cannot tell you when interest rates are going to increase, but I can tell you three things to watch for. How's that? And one of the things is, in Soybean Digest, occasionally I will update these. Watch your unemployment rate. Just came out, 6.1%, but by the way, that is not the real unemployment rate. It's actually 12.2%, and that is what your Federal Reserve is watching. That is called your discouraged worker, the person that's kind of given up. They're watching that really, really closely, okay? And if you see that number start going down, you start seeing this go down in below the 6 range, spring of next year, they're going to start raising interest rates. You know why? Because one of the things they'll keep an eye on is the U.S. economy. And let me go to the U.S. economy. GDP growth rate, negative 2.9. And me and the next speaker, we were talking about this. All the people on Wall Street thinks the U.S. economy is going to go back to a 3% growth rate. I agree with him. I think it's going to be more 1% to 2%. Because, again, you know what's holding our developed countries in the world back? Basically, two or three things. Heavy in debt, slightly dysfunctional government, and I'll leave it at that. And we basically have the Federal Reserve stimulating us. And so, again, that emotion behavior is just not there. The other thing you better keep your eye on, and it's starting to creep up, is inflation. And what's happening is this. Our core without food and energy is 2. Our headline with food and energy is 2.1. And what we need to watch over the summer and into the fall is this inflation starting to come back. Now, over here, you folks, you know what you're saying? inflation's not 2%. In agriculture, it can't be 2%, and you're exactly right. In agriculture, you know what your inflation rate is? Anywhere, it has been anywhere from 4 to 10%. Why? Cash rents have gone up. Your real estate tax has gone up. Input supplies have gone up. And you know why? Because it's called the velocity of money. Number of times this thing called the dollar turns hands. In the general economy, everybody was scared. People kept cash on the balance sheets. Corporations kept it on the balance sheet. Banks kept it on the balance sheet. And it wasn't out in circulation. But in rural America, it was in circulation. So your inflation rate was a lot higher. And so what I am trying to get across is keep an eye on inflation. And here's your bottom line. Unemployment goes below 6. Watch that long-term unemployment. Gets down into the 10 or 11. You happen to see the economy growing at above 2 and inflation start head for 2 to 3, they're going to raise interest rates. And so again, think about this. If you're under 50 years of age in this audience, you've never seen double digit interest rates. And you think about it, we've had no change since 2007, 2008. It's been a good world. Now, talked about the moderation of the super cycle. Let's put it bottom line. Analogous to that old baseball game, it's this. I think the grain industry, you're in the 7th and 8th inning. I'm going to be blunt with you. The easy money's been made, but listen to this. The real good manager is still going to make money. Did you hear that? The good manager will still make money. And you know what one of the big issues is? We're starting to see the softening of the ethanol mandates, the supply-demand, Mother Nature, slowing of the emerging nations. But you know what the critical Achilles heel is for the grain industry right now? It's your high fixed cost structure. And you know, there's an old saying, high prices cure high prices, and she'll do it her this time. And so one of the things that's going to happen over the next couple of years is we're probably going to have to start renegotiating some of that fixed cost down. And again, we've had a lot of complacency in that area. Now, here's the other thing. Somebody asked me in my pre-seminar with my guys over there, it's real interesting. What are a couple of things that we need to keep our eye on? One, the weather. But number two, keep an eye on the livestock industry. It's going to be critical for you. To have a healthy grain industry, you need a healthy livestock industry. Never forget that. Okay? Economically viable. And what's happened was our livestock industry is in the 3rd and 4th inning. Why? The grain industry is so hot. Many of you that had livestock, you said, hey, I'm not going to milk cows. I'm not going to feed hogs. I'm not going to raise beef cattle. I'm going over into the grain industry. And by the way, if you're from 45 to 65, you aren't going to come back, okay? And that's where we see a number of the young folks kind of make their entrance in there. And the thing that I would tell you is they have the livestock industry right now has got a good solid 2 years unless some unusual event comes up. And that is going to be one thing you're going to have to keep your eye on is the economic health of that sector, because it's going to be critical to your whether corn goes back into the 2 range or whether it goes back toward the 4 range. Okay, ooh, 2 and 4. I don't predict markets. Okay, now, real estate. I'm speaking to the National Bison Convention. By the way, you don't call them buffalo. You have to call them bison. I spoke to their international convention. They like me, so they invited me to Denver last year, and you get likes of Ted Turner and all those. Well, I had a bunch of Europeans in the audience. And I wanted outside perspective, because everybody says land is in a bubble. New York Times yesterday, by the way, I got it free in the airport club in Atlanta. I don't buy the liberal magazine, all right? But what's real interesting, you know what it says? Everything's in a bubble. Stock market, farmland, etc. It was amazing, right on the front page. Go to it yesterday. And so the big thing was, I asked this audience of bison people, and by the way, they own a lot of farm ground. I says, do you think agriculture is in a bubble? And I says, nobody from the United States can answer this. And I had a bunch of people in from Europe. One of the guys from the UK, he says, I don't see a bloody bubble. Kind of shocked me, put me back. He says, I see a bloody balloon. And I says, well, where do you see it? He says, that upper Midwest. And you know, folks, I would just have to tell you, how is this different in the 70s and the 80s? Back then, you think about it, I cut my teeth. One of my big mentors was Dr. Tom Fry, University of Illinois. I often mention it out here because He was so patient with me, gave me guidance and everything. But back then, you think about it, it was a credit bubble. Okay? Today, she's an asset bubble. And what's the difference? With a credit bubble, you'll see a quick correction. With an asset bubble, it'll be slow, and painful because you've got more money in the game, skin in the game. And you know what? The thing that will keep the bubble from going down fast is the amount of liquidity in the area, the cash and the liquidity in the area. And if you think about who's been buying farm ground, it's basically been your growing agriculture producers, and some of those are starting to feel it. They're starting to feel it because they plowed all their profits right into growth without holding back working capital. And then you're 60 to 95 year old. Hey, they don't trust Wall Street, so they invest in farmland. Good for them. But here's an old saying. When you start seeing outside investors come into agriculture, watch out. You're late in the cycle. She's in long in the tooth. It happened in the 70s and the 80s. And you know what to be the first to go? Marginal farm ground. And marginal farm ground is just not your soil quality, it's also your field structures, et cetera, et cetera. And remember, all real estate is local, okay? And so there's those dynamics. So what do I see as far as farm real estate? It would be a slow decline, much slower on the east and west coast, southern part of the United States, but boy, that upper Midwest, you think about it. North Dakota right now. You ever fly over North Dakota? It looks like New York City with all the gas wells coming out. And no, it is. And all that hot money is just buoying up the farmland in that area. I just spoke to a district attorney's meeting. Matter of fact, you know where the biggest drug traffic is right now? North Dakota. You know what the drug of choice is? They call it Gator. You inject it between your fingers and it makes your fingers look like alligators. Yeah. And remember, generally speaking, hot times brings the riffraff to town, okay? And that is definitely happening up there. Now, let's kind of, whoops, there we go. All right, I want to bring it down to a conclusion. Want to keep everything on time. And by the way, here's what I want you to do. Before I hit this is going to be important. I want everybody to stand up and shake hands with five people you don't know because networking is important. Everybody stand up, come on. Before I hit my final ones. Let me pick on you.
You're doing a good job.
Well, thank you. Hey, this is fun. Hey, I keep bringing you up. I'm not introducing you yet, okay? Oh, hey, there we go. I got one more to go. I'll shake it again. There we go. All righty. Oh, hi. Okay. I had to do that because, thank you, sir. One of the things is all men over 50 had to go to the portable toilets, okay? Just like the commercial. By the way, can I give you a little hint? Always drink warm water. Don't drink coffee before you speak or eat dairy products because you'll get hoarse. Did you realize that? So just a little tip. Hey, and my lady over here, you kind of walked in front of me. Were you going to take pictures of me? Or? Ready to go? Look out. Look out. Do you take all the pictures of the former governor of this state? Do you? Okay. Yeah, I hear his hair's turned gray in prison because he couldn't dye it. Okay, all right. Well, I'll also have to put that, Joe. I thought about that coming down the highway this morning. All right, you folks doing okay out there? Okay, let's bring her home. Final 10 minutes, all right? I've talked a lot about global economics. Remember, volatility is going to create a lot of opportunity. Talked about technology, but it's more than technology. It's about innovation. Talked about being efficient before you get bigger. Now, and I also talked about the Federal Reserve is basically driving us into complacency. Now, I got thinking about this, and I was coming down Interstate 74. By the way, my Google Earth type of directions, you know where it took me? It took me over to Gates, the corporation over there, and I go, this doesn't look like a cornfield. And I says, well, maybe Bill owns this place. Okay, whoops, there he goes. He's got the phone coming. There we go. All right. And so I finally found directions out here. Now, what's real interesting? What's the equation for success? P equals O plus C plus L plus M squared. And let's go through this one, because there's a lot in this equation. Folks, here's one revelation that I've seen. It could be this family business that's hosting this. It could be your individual farm business. There's two things. Generally speaking, most profitable businesses have good people. And to attract and retain good people, good suppliers, lenders, one of the things is you've got to have what? A profitable business. They go hand in hand. Now, let's talk profits first. Folks, I call it the 60-30-10 principle as far as profitability. If you look at your profits, 60% probably will be allocated toward growth and efficiency, but efficiency before growth. Better is better before bigger is better. The mistake that many of your bigger growing agriculture producers has made, they put all 100% of that equation into growth. It'll come back to bite them. 30% should be allocated toward working capital, and that's just not cash, but a part of it is cash. One recommendation I'm making, at least 1 year of your debt service payments in cash in the bank. Now, you know what a lot of you are going to say in Illinois, Iowa? That's not earning me any rate of return. Your key in success is to be able not to have to sell a discounted asset when the market's going against you. And you know what happens when you have cash? When that market deflates, you pick up other people's assets at 80 cents, 70 cents on a dollar. That's your return on asset. There's a book called Great by Choice by Jim Collins. And one of the things that he talks about is the most successful businesses are very disciplined on cash. It's not all about the return of today or 90 days from now. Sometimes you've got to have dry powder. And some of you will understand that over the next 4 or 5 years. Second element is 10%. Do what you need to do. Have fun. Enjoy yourself. But the big problem is when 10% becomes 70%. And we've seen it. We call it in the form of KTs. What are KTs? Killer toys. No, it's not red paint. It's not green paint. It's not blue paint. It is outside capital investment. You folks from Iowa, it's your lake houses. Out in Nebraska, it's helicopters. Oh, and how do we justify it? Section 179. We can write $500,000 off. How do we justify it? Got to go out and check the livestock, but the livestock are in a confinement system, okay? A drone would be much better, folks. There we go. But one of the things that you will find is keep your dividends and your living costs modest. It's called the 60-30-10 rule. Okay, 60% efficiency growth, 30% build working capital, and then 10% enjoy yourself. Let's go to the people side of the equation. I got a famous rule. It's called the 40-20-40 rule as far as people are concerned. 40% of people you don't want around you. Now, and sometimes they're family members. Feel like they're entitled, the world owes them a living. You bring them on, they'll bring you down financially, but the key thing is they'll bring you down mentally. Okay, you didn't bring this guy on because he had a poor attitude, I don't think. Okay? Yeah, oh, he's along for the ride, okay, Mr. Entitled here, all right. But all joking aside, in seriousness, I have found two types of people you stay away from. Victims and know-it-alls. Victim-alls blame somebody else for their problems, and know-it-alls forgot how to learn. I'll leave it at that. And again, your rise to success will be through people. I was asked over in Spokane, Washington last winter, what's one element different than our parents and grandparents? We are gonna be, in the future, instead of independent like our parents and grandparents, we're gonna be interdependent. We're gonna have to deal with people. There's no doubt about it. All the way from the public, to employees, to suppliers, lenders, you name it. So that's the P part of the equation. Here's the one that scares me. Our O part of the equation, it's called overhead cost. It's way out of hand. Cash rents are not globally competitive. Our farmland is not globally competitive, okay? And one of the things that I would tell you is this. We probably will see some entrenchment on those overhead costs. And boy, you're really gonna have to look at that part in the equation. Next one is C in the equation. The big question I could ask my pre-seminar guys, you know what? One question I would ask them, do you know your cost of production? Okay? And you know what? If you don't know your cost of production, you're still okay and you've been okay, but you know what you're called? Pure production plant manager. And the last 8 years you've been able to do it, but in the next 4 or 5 years you aren't gonna be able to do it. And you're gonna have to know it via enterprise so you can shift your various enterprises out there. Sounds like something that's very simple. It's one of the things that we do in our business is monthly. We do our projections and we compare to actuals, and we're constantly making that change and tweaking our business as game conditions change. We're just like quarterbacks. We got Peyton Mannings out there, okay? One of the things is we go Omaha, hurry, hurry. The ball goes over the head. We have to make an adjustment, okay? And one of the things that I will tell you, cost of production is important. The next thing is this working capital. I'm going to give you a metric. I don't use the old-fashioned current ratio. Go in, meet with your lender. And your working capital needs to be about 25 to 30% of your revenue. And that's not all cash. It's grain in the bin. But you know what? One question your lender's going to ask you, have you got a marketing risk management program on that? Do you have crop insurance? They're going to start asking, you know, tough questions of you as you go out into the future. And then the other element is M squared, marketing and management. And that's what Matt Roberts will be talking about. And here's one thing. Everybody will come to meetings like this to find the one silver bullet. Folks, success in management is not doing one thing 1,000% better. It's doing 1,000 little things 1% better. It's the devil in the detail. And tonight, as you go back away from here, I want you to think about, and matter of fact, this guy right here, and he's got to write it down. I want him to come up with 5 things that you guys need to do differently based off the meeting today. Well, he will. Okay, but again, he's got to do the same thing for you, okay? But one of the things that I would just tell you is, that is your business success equation. To bring it home, on my next slide, one of the things that's real interesting, I've already talked about the top performing, and I've hit that one there. I want to hit a couple of final principles as I close down this morning. It's called the HUT principle. And what's the HUT principle? It's kind of like football. HUT, HUT! You basically what? You hear, you understand, but you take action. A lot of people will come today to hear. Quite a few of you will understand how it impacts you, but very few of you will take action. That's the key. Taking action, executing, monitoring, and following through. It's called the HUT principle. And boy, here is a big one that I think is important. At least 1% of your revenue needs to be invested for training. Not only of yourselves, but your employees, your neighbor, whatever it will be. Because to stay ahead in this information-based society, it's about what? It's not only about information, it's about applying information, but you know what the other element is? It's out networking with other positive producers and like-minded. That's why I had you shake your hand, you know, with a few people around here, because that's going to be very critical for your success. And then, here is one thing Dr. Kleinfelder really talks about, and I agree with him, and it's one of the things that really turned our businesses around. We have advisory teams, and we meet every quarter. And it's real interesting. Those advisory teams, we meet, we monitor, we execute, and we tweak our business. One of the best things that we have ever done. And again, you know what? If you don't threaten to fire your advisory team at least 2 or 3 times, they aren't challenging you. Because they're going to make you mad. But it's one of the things that you need to do. Because, again, it's about input and tweak in the business. And can I hit one other thing? A lot of you know, if you do read my readings, I work very closely with the lenders. And I work with Farm Credit, banks, FSA, and I work across the board. And you know what I tell each one of those organizations? My whole goal in life is to make agriculture better, okay? And one of the things that I think you're gonna have to really look for in the next 4 or 5 years is the lender that's relationship-based. I like the slogan here, you're more than a number. You're a human being, you're a family. And one of the things that I think will be very important is to have a lender go with you side by side. About twice a year, we have our lenders in, kind of look at our financials, and you'd say, well, you got three letters behind your name, PhD, piled higher and deeper, right? Well, yeah, I'm supposedly an expert. You kind of liked that one, didn't you, okay? But you know what's really interesting? It's always good to have another set of eyes on your business, okay? Because they'll find some of your blind spots, but you know what they'll do? They also tell you what you're doing very, very well. And I will tell you, relationship lender, and here's the whole thing, 60% of your lenders will be under 40 years of age. We got a whole new group, get over it. Some of you gray hairs and no hairs and all that, that's gonna be your new lenders, and sometimes they aren't gonna come from an ag background. But relationship lending is very important. I look for the three C's in a lender. You know what it is? They're conservative in the good times, courageous in the tough times, and consistent all the time. Those are the 10 type for the CEO producer. Well, hey, like to say this. First of all, I'd like to congratulate this company, family-owned business, for being a family-owned business. And one of the things in America, somebody asked me the other day, what do we need to bring America back? Yeah, let's focus on some infrastructure. Let's bring back small business and entrepreneurship and get some of the regulation out. Also, one of the things that I would tell you, agriculture is one of the areas that this country can grow, okay? And one of the things that I also said is this, people in Washington, D.C. occasionally need to get out in the flyover states and find out what's really real, okay? But America is really good, and this morning, saw a bunch of U.S. flags, you know, along the highway. I actually went through the town of Knoxville, and your local police were there. And what was real interesting is this. I often hear people doing a lot of belly aching, but in this country, we do a lot of belly aching. We got the biggest bellies to belly ache with, the least to belly ache about in any country in the world. And you know what the reason is? It's because of agriculture. And if you look at the foundation behind the pyramid of success of any country, it's always agriculture. And I think every one of us in this tent, we have got to be advocates for our industry. Because more and more, as society becomes suburban and urban, they take us for granted. And so again, that is my final challenge. Hey, been fun. I'll be around with you this morning. And it was great seeing a lot of you folks I've seen over the years. And I would like to thank the company for inviting me out to speak. And again, I want to wish you well and have a great summer. And you see these young folks. I'm glad a gentleman brought his daughter in here this morning. You brought the son. You two need to get together, okay? But but it's really good. Her face is getting red. But it's really good, though. To see the young folks coming back into agriculture. And Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young says, you got to teach your children well, and we've got to do that out there. So, hey, thanks again. Been a pleasure being with you this morning. Thank you.